Hey, what's going on, guys? Today we are inside of Affinity Designer, and I want to show you how you can put together your very own custom YouTube thumbnail, as I feel this is one of the most important things that you need to learn when it comes to creating your YouTube channel. So before we go ahead and get started with the design, we need to set up our canvas with the required dimensions. And with a YouTube thumbnail, they require the size to be 1280 pixels by 720 pixels. So if we make our way over to the right hand side, and with the page width, you just go ahead and set that at 1280. And with the page height, just go and set that at 720. As for the DPI, you can leave that the way it is, as we're not going to print this, so that is going to be irrelevant to this project. Then once you've set your page width and height, if you want to go ahead and save it as a preset like I've done just over here on the left hand side, then just head back over to the right hand side. At the top of the page, we have this little round circle with a plus symbol inside of it. And that is how you would save that as a preset. So with your canvas all set up and ready to go, all we need to do is head down to the bottom right hand corner and just hit that create. Then from here, we just need to import some images that we're going to use inside of our thumbnail. But before we begin, what I feel is important to note is that anything that you create inside of your thumbnail design needs to be relevant to your video itself. And what I mean by that is don't just throw in any random images that have nothing to do with what you're talking about, or any kind of content that may mislead your viewers and lead to you getting some bad feedback or dislikes on your video. So with that in mind, I'm just going to throw together any kind of random design just as a demonstration. However, any kind of thumbnail that you are creating yourself is going to follow these same kind of procedures. The main difference being is you're just going to use different images yourself and different titles. So with that said, let's go ahead and get started. So I'm going to base this thumbnail being on maybe a photography page, maybe somebody just teaching photography to beginners. So the best thing to do in that case, if you are featured in the video yourself, then I feel it's always best to have an image of yourself on your thumbnail. However, if you're more like me and what you do is teach people how to use certain programs or graphic design, etc., and are not necessarily featured in the video, then in that sense, it's kind of best to have images of the program that you are using in the thumbnail or the design that you have created. But like I stated, just make sure that anything you're using your thumbnail is relevant to your video. So with all of that out the way, let's go ahead and get started with the design. So the first image I'm going to bring in is going to be of a subject. So this could be either yourself or whatever it is you are talking about. But for me, just for this demonstration, I'm going to use stock images. So I'm going to head over to the right hand side of my interface and choose stock. If you guys also want to use a stock section, but you're not seeing that, then just head over to the top menu bar on the left hand side. Go to where it says view, make your way down to studio, and just make sure that you've got that stock section checked, and that will give you access to that also. And for those of you who don't understand what the stock feature is for, it gives us access to thousands of images which are free to use. All that they require is that you give written credit to any of the photographers or creators of the images by simply adding their name to anything you may have created. Other than that, you can use these images however you like. So the first thing I'm going to search for is maybe either a girl or a boy, preferably somebody happy. So I'll just go ahead and type in smile and see what I can find. Then it's just a case of going through all of these images to find something that you like. So straight away, I see this one down here with this girl with a camera, which is going to be perfect for this demonstration. And as you can see, while I've hovered over this, we can see the name of the person who created this image. So just drop that down and write that wherever you may need to put it. Then to use this inside of our project, it's just a case of clicking and dragging that over. And what you may find with most of these stock images is that they are really big images and you may have to shrink these down to fit to your canvas. So first of all, I'll do that using Command or Control minus just to zoom out so I can find these handles. And I'll just make that a little bit smaller by dragging that in and get that to the rough size I'm going for. So I'm going to bring that over to the left hand side. And the idea for me is I kind of want to make sure I've got the camera in the frame as well as the subject's face. So that is going to be pretty good for what I want. And because this has been shot in portrait, I'm losing half of the other side of the image. So the best thing to do here is maybe combine two together. So if I make my way back over to the stock section and find something that's going to blend well with that background, maybe somewhere in a garden section, just for that greenery, then once again, it's a case of going through all of these images to find something that you may like or something that will complement the image that you are using. So I think I'm going to go for maybe this flower right there, as that looks as though it'll match that pretty well. So I'm going to drag that once again over to the canvas. And just like before, that's far too big. So we're going to go ahead and shrink that down. So I'll just drag that down from one corner and just align that to where I want it to go. Just make sure that fits the canvas. And what I also want to do is just drop the opacity on this just for a moment. And that is just for me to line it up to where I want it to be. So if I go back over to the layers on the right hand side, just go to the opacity and just drop that down so I can see through it. And I'll zoom back in at this point with Command or Control 0 to fit to screen. And the idea here is when I blend these two images together, I want to make sure that the camera is going to be inside of this image on the right hand side. However, I still want this flower to be visible over on top of this image. So this is why I dropped the opacity, just to line it up to roughly where I want it to go. So somewhere around there is going to be perfectly fine. So with that done, I can put the opacity back to 100%. And what I'm going to do next is just drag our subject above the flowers, as it's going to be easier to start painting away some of this image. Then what we're going to do next is head back over to the right hand side and select the layer with our subject. And we're going to apply a mask. And to do that, we'll head down towards the bottom where we have this little rectangle with a circle inside of that. And then we just go ahead and select that, and that'll give us a mask. Then with that done, what we need to do is make sure we select the mask itself and just make sure that is highlighted just like that in blue. Then we're going to head over to the top left hand side of our interface to where it says pixel persona. And this is where we can start cutting out some of this image to blend in with the other one. So once we are inside of our pixel persona, what we need to do is go to the left hand side toolbar menu, and we're going to select our paintbrush tool. And the first thing I want to do is start painting away this sharp line that we've got coming straight down the middle. So if we go over to the top left hand side where it says opacity, I'm going to bring that all the way up to 100%. Then I'm just going to start painting away this sharp line that we've got here. You may have to go over this a few times to make it completely disappear, just like that. And for any of you guys that are brand new to using masks and have got no idea how this works, all you really need to know is that black is going to reveal what is underneath the current layer. So underneath this subject that we got right here. So as I'm painting over that now in black, it's starting to reveal the layer underneath that, which is our flower. If you find you took off far too much and you want to bring it back, all you need to do is flip that black to being white, paint back over that, and it'll start bringing that image back just to where we started at the beginning. So in a nutshell, just use black to reveal the layer underneath it, which is going to be our flower, and use white to bring it back if for any reason you made a mistake. So I hope you understand what I mean by that. So moving on, I've got to flip back over to the black as I want to start removing some of this. I'm going to keep going over this edge to get rid of that. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go back over to the top left hand side to the opacity, and I'm going to drop my brush down to around 50%. And I'm going to start making my way over this again, just to get that to fade a little bit more subtly than it was before. But at this point, I'm going to make my brush a bit bigger using the left and right bracket keys on my keyboard. And then I can just start trying to blend these two images in together just to look a little bit more natural. And then maybe times you have to change the size of your brush just to get around little details such as a camera here. So I'm just going to draw around here to get a bit more greenery underneath that. So somewhere around there is going to be perfectly fine. And I'll start going over this flower here because I want this in the image as well. So just keep going around that and over that just to bring that detail back. And you can get as fussy or creative as you like with this and just get it to however you like. So I'm just going to keep going around it just for a moment just to get some of these details that I want in the image. So that isn't looking too bad for me at the moment. Once again, I'm going to make my brush a bit bigger just while kind of subtly just blend these in together. And just like I said, if you took out too much and you want to bring that back, just go back over and flip that over to being white. And then you can just bring some details back if you want, just maybe around this area. But for now, that isn't looking too bad, so I'm going to leave that the way it is. If anything, I think these greens are a little bit more vibrant than the greens that was on this original image, so I may go in and change that a little bit. And to do that, I'll head back over to the right-hand side layer section. I'm going to select the flowers. I'm going to come down towards the bottom to where we have our effects and our adjustments. We're going to choose adjustments, and inside of here, I'm going to look for selective color. And what I want to target in here are going to be the yellows. So I'm just going to drag that yellow down a little bit just to make those greens a little bit lighter. So somewhere around that 65 or 60 is going to be pretty good. And now that green is definitely matching it a little bit better over here. So I'll go ahead and leave that the way it is. What I also want to do next is just brighten up the entire image altogether. So if I just select the female at the top here, then we just need to apply another adjustment. So if we go back down towards the bottom, and this time around we are going to choose vibrance, which is that one right there. So you may notice that this has put this adjustment layer inside of the image of our female or subject, and that's not where we want it to go. So what we need to do is select that by itself and just drag that back out above the other two layers. That then is going to affect everything that is underneath it. So if we go ahead and adjust this vibrance now to make that a little bit brighter. So I'll change the saturation, bring that up a little bit and put that roughly maybe around 40. In fact, that may be a little bit too bright. So I'll go ahead and put that about 30 instead. And then that is looking a lot better to me. So I'll go ahead and close that. So at this point, this is our background image completely finished. So what I'll do is I'll select all of these and group them together. So with the adjustment layer selected at the top, if you hold down shift and you select the bottom one, that is going to select what's in between that and select all of those. Then you hit command or control G to create a group. And we can just go ahead and call that background. And now we can continue creating the rest of this thumbnail. So what I'm going to do next is add a border around the image. But before we go ahead and do that, we need to change personas. So if we go back up to the top left hand side and we go back into our designer persona, then we'll just make our way down to our shape building tools. And I'm going to select this rounded rectangle right there. I'm just going to drag from one corner to the other. So just let that snap in one side down to the other and let that snap as well. Just like that. Then what I want to do is change the radius of these corners. So if we come up to the top menu bar to where it says corner, at the moment this is on 25. So I'm going to bring that down to roughly around 5% as I want this to be a little bit rounded. Then we need to remove this black so we can see through that. So if we come over to the right hand side and we select the black and we just make that transparent. Then with the stroke color in the background, you can have any color that you like. I'm just going to go with white for that. Then I want to make that a little bit thicker. So I'm going to come over to the top left hand corner to where it says stroke. And inside this menu right here, I'm going to change that from 1 point to being 3 points, just to make that a little bit thicker. Then what I want to do next is I want to make it a little bit smaller and leave an even gap all the way around the image. And this can be quite difficult to do if you try and do it manually. So if I just try and drag this in right now, we can see that we've got a bigger gap on the right hand side and on the left hand side than we do at the top or the bottom. So the easiest way to get this even all the way around is just to go backwards for a moment with Command or Control Z, just to put that back to where we started. Then if you pay attention to the bottom right hand corner to our transform menu, you can see inside of here with the width and the height, we have our 1280 and our 720. So what we need to do at the end of these numbers is just put a minus and the amount of pixels that you want to decrease. So I'll put 20 and just do the same on both of the width and the height. So underneath this as well, you put minus 20, hit enter. Then we'll make our way up to the top menu bar to our alignment options right here. And we're going to align horizontally as well as vertically, hit apply. And now that is perfectly spaced between the top and the bottom and the left and the right. So you can see how easy that was to do. So next I want to make the border look a little bit better. So I'll go over to the right hand side, select my border. I'm going to go back to the stroke section on the top left hand side. And I'm going to change this to be a dotted line. And I'll change the cap as well to be a butt cap, which is the one in the middle. And I want these dashes to be a little bit bigger. So I'm going to come down to the bottom here to where it says dash. I'm going to change that to 10. And then I'll close that down. And this kind of gives us that visual representation of looking through a camera. So I'm quite happy with the way that looks. What we want to do now is just add the title of the video itself. So we'll go back over to the left hand side. We'll select the artistic text tool and we'll just start typing out what it is that we want to write. So I'll type photography for beginners. Then I'm going to select all of this with Command or Control A. I want to go up to the top menu bar and change the color to be in white. And I also want to change the font of this. So I'm going to go over to my font section. I want something a little bit bold. So I'll go for that impact right there. Then it's a case of grabbing our move tool and just adjusting the size to be a size that you are going to be happy with. So I'm going to put that roughly where I want it to go and just make that little bit bigger. So somewhere around there is going to be perfectly fine. Then we'll just add a drop shadow to our text as it always looks better. So if we go back over to the right hand side, down towards the bottom to where it says effects. Inside of here, we'll choose outer shadow. And for the radius and the offset, I'm going to give that about 3 pixels on each one of those. And hit enter, and then that looks pretty good. So at this point, we're nearly finished, but what I want to also do is just add a little subtitle down there at the bottom. So just to be quicker, I'll copy this right here with Command or Control C and Command and Control V to paste. I'll just select all of that And I'll just type something else in here, such as confidently go from auto settings to manual. Then it's just a case of making our text smaller and then moving that into position. So I'm going to put this roughly around 36 points. Grab my move tool and just put that down towards the bottom. So somewhere around there would be perfectly fine. And just to make that a little bit more visible, I'm going to put a shape in the background of that. So if I come back over to the left-hand side and grab my rounded rectangle once again, it's going to draw over that, roughly somewhere around that size. I'm going to remove the border on this one just by turning off my stroke. And with the fill, I'm going to go for maybe a green and go a little bit darker somewhere around that color. And just adjust the size of this just a little bit to make it look that little bit better. And I think I want this border around the entire image to sit behind this green shape that we've got. So over on the right hand side, I'm going to grab that border and drag that towards the bottom. Then it's just a case of lining this up to look that little bit better. So I'll grab my move tool once again and just move it into position. So I'm going to put that roughly around here. In fact, just to make sure I've got perfect spacing, I'm going to snap that into the bottom corner as well as the right hand side. I'm going to then use my arrow keys and just make sure I have that perfectly spaced out. And I'll just select this background shape just to make that a little bit smaller. So somewhere around there is going to be better, and just bring that down a little bit. And that isn't looking too bad. So I'm just going to Command or Control 0 to fit to screen so we can see what we've got. Then the filter finish this off, all we need to do is just maybe bring a picture of a camera in as maybe an icon. So I'll go ahead and search for that on Google right now. So I've just found this image on Google of a camera, which is a transparent PNG, meaning it has no background. And all I did was drag it into Affinity Designer. So I'm just going to make a copy of this layer with Command or Control C to copy. Head back over to our other document, which is our thumbnail, and hit Command or Control V to paste. Then I'll just adjust the size of this to make it a little bit smaller. And I'm going to want this to be white. So the easiest and quickest way of doing this is go over to our effects on the bottom right hand side. And we're going to go to where it says color overlay. And we'll just change that color to be in white. And then that is all we need to do. And I'll go ahead and put an outer shadow on this as well. So just like before, we'll keep that at 3 and 3 on the radius and offset. Hit close. I'm going to rotate this just a little bit with this little round circle on the top, somewhere like that. Make that just a little bit bigger. Just put that into position. And then that is generally it. I'm quite happy with that as a quick thumbnail. And this is definitely something that could be used for anybody teaching photography. Just like I said at the beginning, it doesn't matter what you are making the thumbnail for. All you got to generally do is change the image and the text to be relevant to your video. And the same principles will apply across any project. So with that finished, all we need to do is save it. And we can do that by going up to File in the top left hand menu. Go down to where it says Export. And inside of here, we have multiple different options. But as you're going to be saving this as a YouTube thumbnail, you want to go ahead and save it as a JPEG. Just ensure that your size is 1280 pixels by 720. Go ahead and choose your best quality just down there with 100%. And then just go down to where it says export, give that a name to anything you like, and just go ahead and hit save. And that is all there is to it. So I hope you found today's video useful. If you did, then please go ahead and hit that like button, as that really helps me out with the YouTube algorithm and helps other people find my content. If you are brand new to Affinity Designer or Affinity Photo or Publisher, I do have an entire beginner's course on all three of those on my YouTube channel. So feel free to go and check those out. If you haven't subscribed already, then please go ahead and do so and check out all of my other videos on Affinity Designer, as well as any future releases I may have. But for now, I hope you have a great day, and I will see you in my next video.